Let me ask you something. Do you like books, kid? I got books.
Because of quarantine, like, as far as my standards of reading goes, I've been, like, popping off on the amount of books I've read lately. I have a lot of thoughts about all of them. And I'd like to share. Welcome to the classroom. The first book that I read was Never Let Me Go by Kazuo Ishiguro. I read it with my girlfriend. We both read it together as a sort of, I guess we have our own book club thing going on. It's good. My throat is dying. I've been talking and yelling for more than I have all year, man. So I had no idea what this book was even about when I picked it out, but the little quote on the front from Time magazine calls it a page turner and a heartbreaker. Oof, look at that rhyme. A tour de force of knotted tension and burning anguish. Buried anguish, excuse me. And yeah, that's not a bad take. I also had a good feeling on the back because it's called Gothic, and you guys know how I like the Goths. Ooh, yeah. The Germans, the ancestors. Love those guys, man. But it's kind of a difficult book to talk about without breaking straight into spoiler discussions. Like, even the back doesn't really mention too much about what the actual book is about. But it's about some kids at a boarding school. And it's told from the perspective of one girl who used to go there. Now she's an adult. Now she's something called a carer. She's very good at her job, but because she's very good at her job, she's been doing it for, like, way longer than most carers. And so most likely, she's about to stop being allowed to be one, whether she decides to of her own accord or whether the people who run the carers tell her to stop. She's kind of looking back on her times in boarding school and just her whole entire life, just about. And in particular, there's two best friends that sort of stand out among those people and to even carry on beyond the boarding school. The boarding school's reach, if you know what I'm saying. It's a very, very English-British novel, which I wasn't expecting, because the author's name is Kazuo Ishiguro. I've been, one of my goals in reading was to find more Japanese authors, as you'll later see. And so, kind of took me by surprise that it's a novel that was originally written in English and is by a British folk. But he was born in Japan, moved over here at a young age. And so the movie tackles a lot of, I guess, social issues. Like, hypothetical ones. Like I said, it's difficult to talk about. I love the way that it's written. It has a very nostalgic tone to it. Because she's very nostalgic and telling about it. And so it kind of brought me back to some of my own times in school. So if that's your thing, definitely go for it. There's some romance involved in the book, but it's not like a romantic book necessarily. And I really enjoy the way that was discussed as well. Not just romance in particular, but also like subjects that get brought up when an adolescent is going through puberty. It's a different circumstance, the world that this book is set in, than ours. So it's not as fundamental, although it does end up commenting on some fundamental values, fundamental good old British values. But it's really interesting the way that it's incorporated, and the all the way up into the end. It's nice. It's a very nice book. Good atmosphere. The characters are great too. Principal cast being Kathy, Tommy, and Ruth. And Ruth is a fantastic character. Tommy's a pretty good character. I feel like Ruth could have had more to her that's fleshed out, but she's sort of just your insert relatable character that you're supposed to feel the most connection to, so it makes sense, I guess. And also it's told from her perspective, so everything's presented as if it's normal. You get her inner monologue. You don't get the inner monologue of Ruth or Tommy, and I think that makes them more interesting. Overall, I had a great time reading this book. 7.5 good jobs out of 10. The next book that I want to talk about, this is not the order I read them in. I don't know how I'm supposed to figure out the order. I just reached over and grabbed the first one that fell in my hands. But it was A Farewell to Arms. I think the thing with Hemmingway is I want to love him. I want to have all the feelings that other people have for him, because it's usually very passionate. And I have a mustache. He has a mustache. I mean, all the stars are lining up for me to be a huge Hemingway fanatic. But after two books, this is my second book by him. I only like him. I don't love him. It's not like some kind of intense thing for me.
I don't know why.
But I really like this copy of the book. I did like A Farewell to Arms more than the other book that I read by him, which was The Old Man and the Sea. And I think one of the reasons is that A Farewell to Arms is almost just straight up autobiographical. It's set during World War I about an American ambulance driver who's in the employ of the Italian army, which is exactly what Hemmingway was. And while he was on duty, he got injured and was sent to a hospital, just like in the book, where he fell in love with one of the nurses there. And that's about where it ends, because in real life, they had like a little fling, but then she was like, you're a little young, I don't really see this working out, and she kind of dumped him. But in the book, they end up not happy together, but they do end up together until the end of the book. Yeah, I wouldn't feel so bad about spoiling this one, because it's so old and it's so classic that you probably already know most of what happens in it, even if you don't realize that you do. There was like a movie that I've heard is alright. Even though I'm not in love with Hemingway's writing style per se, I can absolutely see how someone would be. From the part of the book where he gets injured, there's this one really cool part that I'm just gonna read verbatim real quick, like I'm in a beat poetry cafe. I tried to breathe, but my breath would not come, and I felt myself rush bodily out of myself, and out, and out, and out, and all the time bodily in the wind. I went out swiftly, all of myself. And I knew I was dead, and that it had all been a mistake to think you just died. Then I floated, and instead of going on, I felt myself slide back. I breathed, and I was back. Like, it's really... I do like his style, for the most part, and in fact, I'm a pretty big fan during the big paragraphs where he's just writing about what's happening, what his experience is, but the part that I feel like is just tedious is the dialogue. There are moments where the conversation itself can be really funny, but the way it's written is just, it doesn't describe who said the line previous or after. It's just like a long line of line after line of back and forth dialogue between the characters. You have to keep in mind who's talking to who in the scene as you're reading it. Mentally keep track as you switch back and forth, and so if they're not talking about something interesting, it's just like... kind of tedious. I guess this book just sucks for a page then. Okay, can we get back to the cool bits? Thematically, I appreciate the way that it explores the politics of different ranking soldiers in the army, the way that foot soldiers view the war itself as it's going on. I think it is a pretty great and powerful like anti-war book, especially with the ending. The ending is my favorite part. It blew me out of the water and left me beached like a whale on a shore. And so, yes, better than The Old Man and the Sea. The dialogue thing is honestly not that bad. I'd probably give it like an 8 out of 10, maybe. Like, I had lesser feelings before I started talking about it, but as I've been talking about it and like that segment I read out of it, I've just been thinking about like a bunch of other parts of the book that I really like. I feel like anything lower than an 8 out of 10 wouldn't really cover my feelings of the book. So there you go. All right, book number 3. This is What It Means When a Man Falls from the Sky by Leslie Nneka Arimah. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. I'm kind of going phonetically on that one. This one is not a novel, but a collection of short stories. A Nigerian-British author. And I think what's really the most impressive about this is just how many styles and genres the book covers. She leaps all over the place. It's really impressive that they still all fit together and feel cohesive, and like it doesn't feel weird when you switch from sci-fi to folktale. It feels like they're both still a connection from the same culture, from the same mind. It's like humans are humans no matter the age or the era. Good stuff. As you might say. Just about every short story in here is a banger, and I recommend you read the whole thing, but some of my favorites are like Wild, Who Will Greet You at Home, What It Means When a Man Falls from the Sky, the one that's from the title, It Better Be Good Boy, and then Gloria and Redemption. Each one pretty much leaves you feeling... Everyone pretty much leaves you with chills. There's not really any particular exception. Although I wouldn't say that all of them are perfect or anything. What even is perfection, man? Who knows? What is a rating system? Why would I rate these books? Do I recommend this book? You bet your gosh darn heckin' tootie I do. These are really fun short stories, packed with meaningful and relevant ideas and topics from an up-and-coming brilliant mind. I mean, there's nothing here that would prevent me from recommending it. I'm not going to spoil anything, but I will say what it means when a man falls from the sky is a sci-fi story in which the code of what makes a human has been figured out through the use of mathematical formulas, and that what is a volcano is a humanless folktale about gods of the river and the god of ants and how volcanoes were ever a thing to begin with. And it feels like you're sitting around a campfire for both stories, surrounded by good people and good culture. And I love this book. I'm 8.5 to 9 for me, bruh. But like I said, what does that mean? Next book is another collection, and you've probably heard of this fella and probably read the last short story in this book, James Joyce's Dubliners. Ooh yeah, now my mustache is making sense. I'm going on a James Joyce rampage right now, guys. I bought all of his books, the ones that I didn't have. I already had Dubliners. It's been on my list for a long time, but I read The Dead for College, which is the last short story in this. That sealed the deal, especially after I took a glance at Finnegan's Wake and had a mental stroke trying to figure out what the first sentence even meant. But thankfully, this book is super easy to read. There are a few things that you're probably gonna end up Googling, but most of those are just like because of the time period, and it wouldn't have been too weird or difficult for someone reading it at the time if they knew anything about Dublin or Ireland at all. The whole book does take place in Dublin, every short story, and it's all about different characters, but they go in ascending order of age for the characters and for the themes, based on what you would encounter growing up in Dublin, basically. It's like an excellent snapshot of what it was like at the time, exploring the themes and offering his own thoughts on the political challenges. Dublin was very poor, it was kind of subjugated by England at the time, you know, they weren't willfully a part of the UK, and even though they were a part of it, they weren't being helped by England at all, even as they went through various famines and poverty streaks. There was basically just huge, there was a huge wealth gap between Dubliners and Englanders, although there were rich people in Dublin, which this book does cover, who are basically like no better than English people, is what Joyce is saying. Because the Dublin that Joyce is painting is very much one that's in stagnation. This is sort of after a lot of the fervor of separation from England had occurred. And you definitely get that in the book. It was actually banned in Dublin at the time because it was counterculture before counterculture was a thing. Like, I want to say revolutionary, but it wasn't. It was just very critical of the government and critical of the way things were. I'd say that I truly loved and enjoyed every single one of the short stories in the book. I even reread a bunch of them just because it was so fun reading them. And because, I mean, it's kind of difficult to figure out exactly what he's trying to say sometimes. A lot of the times you get, like, basically one element in it, but then as you reread it, you get more and more that starts to reveal itself to you. Even though it's easy to read, that doesn't mean it's not packed full of meaning. And basically things that you're never going to get unless you look up other people analyzing it that have more knowledge about James Joyce and the state of Dublin at the time. But some of my favorites were like Araby, which is like a story about infatuation and unrequited love. Two Gallants, which it feels like a biblical parable, really, but like set in Dublin. I really liked the pacing of that one and like all the different meanings that it could have. Like I was just looking up some of them because I had a few of my own in mind, and there were like so many more than that. Also Counterparts, The Sisters, and The Dead, of course, which is just basically a novella. It's way longer than all the other short stories, and it's the most important one. It's the one that you read at the end of all of them that kind of ties everything up and makes it the quote-unquote masterpiece that it is. I will say the one I didn't enjoy reading very much at all was Ivy Day in the Committee Room, which is like a bunch of old people sitting around drinking beer and talking about the political state. of Ireland and like a candidate who's running. They're like, most of them are supporting this one candidate who's running, and they're also talking about Parnell, who's this other important political figure for Irish nationalism, who died, and now there's like no one who can replace him. So they're just kind of settling on this particular candidate, and it's just very political and very not fun to read. Right, and here's the last physical book that I read, which is The Sailor Who Fell from Grace with the Sea by Yukio Mishima. And I wanted to read something about a sailor, but Moby Dick was too long. I played the game The Return of the Oberdin, and I was like, I have to know more about ships now. Ships during the time, I'm just like in love with that romanticized version of a really big boat with lots of people on it, out on the sea with the violent winds and trying to make sure it sails to its destination, avoiding pirates and having some real characters on board who are going as passengers, you know. So this isn't like that at all, but it does have a sailor in it, and it does include its own commentary on the romanticism of the sea, but it's way deeper than I thought it would be, and it's like getting bludgeoned in the head by a Bushido philosopher, because that's pretty much what it is. It's really violent while having very little violence in it at all, and it's very philosophical while also being entirely prose and entirely a blast to read. I kind of adore this book for all the things in it that I disagree with. It has a lot of things that I do agree with, and a lot of things that just kind of ring with something in me primally. Probably like my caveman brain. It's interesting because Dubliners kind of deals with a country very unsure of itself, with a national branch that seeks independence. And this is another book that deals with an unsure country that also has a powerful national presence. And it's written by one of the big boys of Japanese nationalism of his particular brand, Yukio Mishima, who believed that the Bushido codes should never have been taken out of Japanese culture and political influence, and it's sort of grossly oversimplifying things. This isn't about Yukio Mishima, it's about his book, but it's kind of hard not to touch on it a little bit when going into it. The book basically has three major characters. There is Ryuji, who is the sailor. There is Noboru, who is a child, and Fusako, who Ryuji is currently romancing. Noboru being Fusako's kid, he like sees Ryuji as this like perfect idealized version of all of his philosophical ideas, because Noboru, unlike all the other 13-year-olds, is part of this gang of like highly philosophical stoic-y Bushido pro-violence kids, and they're like 13, but they're basically a cult at this point. And so they have meetings where they like talk about their parents and various adults in society and how like sad and pathetic they are compared to their own philosophical ideas, because they read so much and they know so much. And especially the leader, who is like this total sociopath who like doesn't understand empathy and only knows his philosophy and his philosophy books, and shuns anything that doesn't match up with this particular like very masculine, very primal idea. And the one thing in the world that like perfectly epitomizes everything that people and man should be, it's like it is the sea. The sea is like the ultimate epitome of all of their ideals. It's perfection. And Ryuji, being a sailor who's like devoted his life to the sea, is almost like this savior figure to them. And especially to Noboru, he's like fully convinced and tells his friends that like Ryuji is gonna be like this very important person to them and to their philosophy even. And there's not like this implication that he's gonna do something important. It's just like the fact that he does embody all of this belief, there is something kind of esoteric that he is accomplishing that no other adult in their society that they can think of is doing. And so anything that he does contrary to this idealized version of their beliefs is a betrayal. But Ryuji decides he wants to marry Noboru's mom, and that is a huge betrayal. So that's what the book is about, and I'm not gonna spoil the rest. But it it gets fun. It gets so fun and it gets so disturbing, and it's not for the faint of heart. But if that interests you, you have to read this. You have to get into Yukio Mishima. If that interests you, even if you don't agree with him politically, you got to, man. It's so good. It's gripping. I couldn't stop reading it. I read it in like 2 days, which is huge. So yeah, that's all I read and as far as physical books, and that's like the most of one of what I wanted to talk about. I also read The Castle of Otranto. It sucked. It's considered the first gothic novel of all time, which is why I read it. And I don't know, it didn't feel like it was worthy of my time reading it. There were some parts that were fun, there were some parts that were funny, and I'm not sure if it was supposed to be funny, or if it's supposed to be a satire of medieval literature, like Song of Roland and stuff like that, then maybe I could change my mind about it. But as it was presented to me and as I read it, it was meh. It is very chauvinistic and gross in that way, so it just didn't really appeal to me. Another book that I listened to while walking was Norse Mythology, and really all I wanted to, by Neil Gaiman, and all I really wanted to say about it is that I listened to it while hiking out in the woods, and his description of everything that's happening in the book matched so perfectly to like that outdoor setting, and like the slight chill of fall. It gave me chill bumps. A bunch of the stories did, and a bunch of the descriptions did, and it's the best way to experience it, is to just go hiking, slip on some earbuds, and just intently listen while you experience nature, and like compare things that you're actually seeing to what he's talking about in the book. There's this one point where he's talking about an eagle that's perched up in like the highest branch of the tallest tree, and so I looked up for the tallest tree, and it was like so freaking high up there, and so I was just imagining this ginormous eagle in the tallest tree up there, and it was super powerful, and I don't know, there's nothing about it that's really life-changing or anything, but it was really fun, so I highly recommend you do that. I also read I Am Legend on ebook, and there's nothing to say about it that hasn't already been said, but it's cool. It's vampires. It's, the ending was different than I thought it would be, and it gave me chills also. So there you go. That's my book review. So next month, or like whenever I make another one of these, I'm gonna talk about more books. So I just wanted to like give you guys a heads up on what they're gonna be in case you wanna read them before I do it. First I have Naked Lunch by William S. Burroughs, which I've heard is a really silly trivia book about drugs and stuff. It's also by like one of the main figures of the Beatnik movement, with like Allen Ginsberg and Jack Kerouac and stuff, so I feel like I have to read it. There's also The Sellout by Paul Beatty, because I want to read more black literature, especially with all that's happening in the world. Like, I feel like it's important to woke up a bit, and I've also heard it's really funny and satirical. I'm also going to read A Portrait of the Artist as a Young Man by James Joyce, because, like I said, we're reading all of them on this channel. I'm also going to read Dune, which I'm already a little bit of the way through. I started it not too long ago. And Haruki, Murakami, The Wind-Up Bird Chronicle. Yeah, I know that's two very thick books, and that's like a lot of books, but I know you can do it, and I hope to God that I can do it. No, yeah. So I hopefully you can read along, or not. Or this is the last one, who knows. I'm gonna go to bed now, I'm tired. I'm gonna edit this first and upload it, but then I'm gonna go to bed because I'm tired. See you guys.